All right, let's return to our second messengers, cyclic AMP and inositol triphosphate, and also diacylglycerol. These are all second messengers. And let's start with inositol triphosphate, the fusible product caused by the cleavage of PIP2 by phospholipase C. And let's remember what IP3 does, and look at some examples of how it has an effect. And then we'll briefly consider diacylglycerol as well. And then we'll move on to considering cyclic AMP as a second messenger as well. So you'll remember that phospholipase C cleaves PIP2 into diacylglycerol and also IP3. And you'll remember that IP3 as a second messenger causes the release of calcium from intracellular stores, from the lumen, if you will, where calcium is stored at high concentrations. And calcium will flows down its concentration gradient when particular calcium channels open in the endoplasmic reticular membrane. And that happens when IP3 diffuses away from the membrane where it was cleaved from PIP2 and causes the release of calcium by binding to these channel proteins, which open up in response and allow calcium to flow into the cytoplasm. Now, there are numerous calcium binding proteins that can cause a cellular response to all this. So one of them is called calmodulin, and calmodulin the structure of calmodulin is a long alpha helix separated by two domains. One domain which binds two calcium ions, and another domain which also binds two calcium ions. And calmodulin, as its name implies, is modulated by binding to calcium. So calmodulin is inactive except when calcium is bound to it. And when calcium is bound to it, it can activate other proteins that become active by binding calmodulin. So calmodulin is a kind of a master regulator, which in turn is regulated by binding of calcium. Now, the downstream effects, if you will, of calmodulin are many and varied, and we're not going to go into too many details about what happens when downstream proteins are activated by calmodulin. But just know that these activated proteins that are activated by calmodulin can elicit a variety of effects, including changes in the transcriptional profiles of cells, so that new genes become turned on or turned off in response to all this. And it's helpful to remember where we all started in this. We started with a ligand, and the ligand activated a G protein coupled receptor, which in turn activated the alpha subunit of a G protein, G alpha, if you will, which exchanged, released GDP and bound GTP when it became activated by a conformational change in the G protein coupled receptor. And this activated G alpha subunit of the heterotrimeric G protein interacted with, and what we've been considering, it interacted with phospholipase C effector protein, which produced IP3 and diacylglycerol. And just considering IP3 here, we saw that IP3 caused the release of calcium from the stores in the endoplasmic reticulum lumen, so that calcium is released into the cytoplasm where it binds to proteins and causes them to be activated. One of those is calmodulin. And calmodulin, when bound to calcium, can activate further downstream proteins. And this can then lead to the cellular response. Cellular response of the cell in response to a particular signaling molecule, an extracellular signaling molecule that was the ligand. So all this pathway resulted in a cellular response caused by calcium binding to calmodulin, which in turn was caused by the release of IP3 and so on. So you can go through this pathway again and again to understand it. And you might want to rewind this to go over it again. Now, what about our diacylglycerol over here? We haven't talked about it yet. Diacylglycerol can diffuse laterally associated with the membrane, so it can move in the membrane, and it can interact with another effector molecule, or I should say a downstream protein, which in this case we're going to talk about is a protein called protein kinase C. And you'll remember that what a kinase is. A kinase is an enzyme that phosphorylates other target proteins. And protein kinase C is a master phosphorylator protein. And just you'll remember your phosphorylation cascades that we've gone over already. Well, protein kinase C is a master phosphorylator that can produce another phosphorylation cascade. And that phosphorylation cascade can result in a cellular response, which can also involve the change in the transcriptional profile of a cell by turning on transcription factors that regulate genes inside the nucleus. So diacylglycerol interacting with protein kinase C can cause cellular responses as well. And it's interesting that calcium ions also help activate protein kinase C. So in this case, we have a synergistic effect of diacylglycerol activating protein kinase C, establishing a protein phosphorylation cascade, resulting in a cellular response, and calcium also activates protein kinase C. So these two things act synergistically. And you'll note that DAG is a second messenger and IP3 is a second messenger. Both then act to activate protein kinase C. But the release of calcium by IP3 from the endoplasmic reticulum can also affect other proteins, other calcium binding proteins that have other downstream effects. So this can be rather complex and involved. And you can kind of gain an appreciation for how intricate these cellular responses are, the signal transduction pathways are. All right, well, we've looked at the diacylglycerol and its effect on protein kinase C, and we've looked at IP3 and its effect on calcium release and therefore downstream effects, and both of these have profound consequences for the cellular response to cellular ligands as stimulated through G-protein-coupled receptors. Well, now let's look at the effect of G-protein-coupled receptors that become activated by particular extracellular ligands, this time when the active G-proteins activate the adenyl cyclase effector protein. We've looked at phospholipase C effects when it becomes activated by the activated alpha subunits of heterotrimeric G proteins. Now let's look at adenyl cyclase in a little more detail in terms of the cyclic AMP second messenger that it produces. So here we are, here's adenyl cyclase. It becomes activated by the alpha subunit of an activated G protein that is associated with a G protein coupled receptor that responds to ligand by causing the activation of that G protein. And we talked about when adenyl cyclase is activated, it produces cyclic AMP from an ATP precursor and also releases two inorganic phosphates. Well, cyclic AMP is a potent second messenger, as we've alluded to, and it one of the things that cyclic AMP can do is activate protein kinase A. We talked about protein kinase C as a master phosphorylator. When it becomes activated by diacylglycerol and calcium, well, protein kinase A is also a master phosphorylator, which in this case is activated by binding to cyclic AMP. And when protein kinase A is activated, it phosphorylates various response proteins that then elicit a cellular response, which can be multifaceted. So let's look at one of those responses in a little bit more detail. So here we're going to look at the response to epinephrine or adrenaline. And you probably all know that adrenaline causes an immediate excitation response in animals, for example, when it is released. So epinephrine released into the bloodstream can cause target cells to respond to that epinephrine in a long signal transduction pathway that will result in the production of glucose that will be released into the bloodstream. And you know that glucose fuels energy production when it is broken down. And we talked before about the signal transduction pathway operating through a protein phosphorylation cascade that leads to the formation of glycogen from glucose. That is, produces the storage form of glucose in glycogen. Well, now we're going to look at how glucose is released from that glycogen in response to something like adrenaline. So adrenaline or epinephrine can cause a fight or flight response. So you turn around and there's a bear or something right behind you, you're going to have an immediate release of epinephrine, and that epinephrine will hit target tissues and will cause the production of lots of glucose, which you might need to either fight or flight, or flee rather. So let's look at this. Here we have adenyl cyclase being activated when epinephrine interacts with its particular G protein coupled receptor. And when that happens, adenyl cyclase produces cyclic AMP, which activates protein kinase A. And protein kinase A phosphorylates a protein called phosphorylase kinase. This is another phosphorylation cascade pathway. And when phosphorylase kinase is phosphorylated by protein kinase A, then it phosphorylates glycogen phosphorylase. So again, this is a protein phosphorylation cascade. Phosphorylase kinase is phosphorylated by protein kinase A, and in turn, phosphorylase kinase phosphorylates target protein glycogen phosphorylase. And this enzyme, glycogen phosphorylase, converts glycogen to free glucose. It chops glucose molecules individually off the storage form of glucose, which is glycogen, often stored in the liver. And that release of glucose can then be an immediate source of energy for a response to whatever it is that is stimulating the release of epinephrine, which is also equals adrenaline. So here is a very particular example of a G protein coupled receptor pathway leading to a very important response and can lead to a behavioral response in organisms. Now you may remember, just by way of jogging your memory here, that previously we looked at how insulin acts through a phosphorylation cascade to stimulate the production or the activation of glycogen synthase, which runs the reverse reaction to what we've just considered. So insulin, you have a lot of glucose in your blood, let's say. Insulin released from pancreas cells will cause target tissues to convert glucose into glycogen, the storage form, because if you have a lot of excess glucose around, you don't need it, and so it's better to save it for a rainy day, if you will, or save it when you need it. And one of the cases that you might need it is a fight or flight response that epinephrine or adrenaline will induce, where we need that glucose, and that would be converted from glycogen to glucose. So we'd release glucose into the bloodstream. And this pathway was run through G protein coupled receptors, whereas the insulin receptor was a different signal transduction pathway. So insulin acted by dimerizing receptor proteins that caused the phosphorylation of an insulin response protein, and so on down the pathway here to convert glucose to glycogen. And we talked about that earlier, so I won't belabor that point here.